Okay, welcome everybody to the afternoon session called Storytelling Through Film, Graphic Art, and Performance. Clearly, I am not Alan McEachern. My name is Michelle Hamilton, although I do have the distinction of replacing Alan as the Director of Public History at Western, so that's our talk. We are going to go in the order of papers which have been in the order that they've been listed on the program. So first we have Ronald Rudin. For those of you who saw his film just previous to this session, you will have some idea of his paper. He is a professor of history and co-director of the Center for Oral History and Digital Storytelling at Concordia University. For those of you who know his work, he often transforms his research not only into monographs, but also websites and films, and this is a good example. Many of his projects have been award-winning. Today he's going to tell us a little bit more about the Lost Stories Project, which seeks out little-known stories in the Canadian past, transforms them into works of public art, as you saw in the film, and then documents that research and a public art process and the idea of storytelling through short films. And the Thomas Wood story is just one, as sort of a pilot project for a larger project, which he may talk about. The second paper will be given by Sean Carleton and Julia Smith. They are both PhD students at Trent University at the Frost Center for Canadian Studies and Indigenous Studies. They are both members of the Graphic History Collective, and hopefully some of you saw their exhibit poster presentation at lunch, and if you haven't, I'm assuming it will still be there later this afternoon during coffee time. The Graphic History Collective blends the tradition of people's history with the medium of comics to produce what they call hopeful histories. Their paper together will explore two of their projects that they have worked on together, May Day, which is one of the comics they've produced, and then a second one which is coming out in 2016 called Drawn to Change, Graphic Histories of the Working Class Struggle. Third then is Mathew Hayes, also a PhD candidate at Trent in the Frost Center. He has also produced his research in many ways, including film. For instance, his short film Tilco Striker tells the story of women workers at a plastics factory in Peterborough on strike in 1965, and it's been screened across Canada and is also available online if anybody wants to see it. His PhD research examines science policy and government secrecy during the Cold War in Canada. He also has an exhibit in the King's Mill Room if you would like to have a look. Today his paper will explore the nature of historical knowledge as it is mobilized and contested in wider society by drawing on three of his projects. One was a series of posters placed around Peterborough, which each featured an anecdote from the city's history. It was turned into a walking tour during the city's Arts Week, and it will also be turned into a podcast in which those stories will be performed orally in the future. So I will turn it over to them. We will have the three papers in succession, and then we will have them presenters come up and sit, and then we can have a discussion and question and answer session.
Well, thank you, Michelle. In the name of full disclosure, for those of you here in the last session, Michelle is part of the group that's trying to move the Lost Stories Project forward, so she's not an innocent observer. Okay, now I'm just looking down here because this thing is not charging. Okay, there we go. Okay, so thanks for everyone for coming. For some of you who've been here for a while, thanks for staying. So these comments are about the Lost Stories Project that some of you know includes a film which was screened just before this session. So for those who've seen the whole film, the point of these comments is to provide some context for what you've seen. For those who didn't, there is a short clip. Sorry about that for those who've already endured this once. You'll see it looks a little different. A short clip at the end, and you can see the whole thing, in fact, from the website whose address is on the screen, which may make some of you wonder, who were sitting here before, why you couldn't have just seen it at home instead of having to sit in the room. But film watching should be a collective experience. So in the 20 minutes or so that I have, I'm going to talk about what the Lost Stories Project is in somewhat broad terms, to explain what brought me to the project, discuss the challenges making the pilot, and so the Making Thomas Wood part, the title, and finish with a short clip, And after everyone has spoken, I look forward to the discussion. So, the Lost Stories Project is designed to collect from the public, that is to crowdsource little-known stories about the Canadian past, to transform those stories into inexpensive works of public art on appropriate sites, and to document the process by way of a series of short films available in English, French, and other appropriate languages. So, the origins of the project. I've had an interest for a long time about how the past is represented in public space. Like many others, I've tried to reconstruct the process by which such representations are created, coming to the conclusion, like many others, that when we see an object like a monument, we're really seeing a monument to the people who constructed it. So here, just to take one of many examples, but one that I'm particularly fond of, Kirk Savage, an American art historian, who's written a terrific book about the creation of the National Mall in Washington, made the point that the Washington Monument, finished in the 1880s, had nothing to do with George Washington and his agrarian world. Rather, it was a monument to modern technocratic wisdom and bureaucratic efficiency. In other words, it was a monument to the people who built the monument as much as it was to Washington. And so we know that, and yet for all that's been written, and you know, with this kind of we call it subset of public history scholarship written over the last 30 years, for all that's been written, we really still have a rather partial view of most physical representations in public space. So, you know, we have what people like Kirk Savage, and I contributed my own small bit to that, and others in the room have as well. For all of that, we really have a very partial view of how any physical representation was actually created. And here's the particular relevance for this conference, I think. We've done very little to communicate the process to the extent that we understand it to a larger public. And so, you know, findings like for Savage's has largely been a kind of internal thing that we talk about among ourselves. I think we've done a pretty awful job, actually, in terms of communicating to a larger public how the past actually gets communicated in the public sphere. So the reality is that there remains, I think, significant sense among the public that such representations are natural. My students certainly tell me this all the time, that when we see a monument or even when we look at a museum exhibit, it had to be that way. There is no obvious selection of no obvious process of selection, and so it's assumed that it had to be this way. And we have significant amount of evidence to indicate there's a large body of public opinion along these lines. One of my favorite's the right word, indications of this comes out of Roy Rosenzweig and David Thalen's The Presence of the Past, who, as I suspect some of you know, was based upon a large survey of American opinion about how the past gets represented and what it means. And they include some of the results of their survey research in their book, and they talk about this man who said when visiting a dinosaur museum and talked about the museum in glowing terms and about how it actually spoke to him in very very specific ways, he said, you know, he really loved the exhibit because the bones are right there and the bones don't lie. Well, you know, someone had to get the bones to the museum, make this choice of selection, display them, caption them, all those things. It seemed kind of obvious to us. And I don't make this point. I'm always a little uncomfortable making it, as if I'm trying to show this guy out to be dumb. That's not really my point. Rather, is I don't think we've done a very good job in working with the public in order to try to explain or work with the public to explain how the past might be, could be represented. And so, with all that kind of background, the Lost Stories Project was created. That sounds grander than it was, and so I created the Lost Stories Project in order to, was created in order to find a way to show this process, to raise questions of how the past is presented in public space, but to try to do it in a way that wasn't too pedantic, right? We didn't want to create a project that would simply clobber people over the head and say, look, you know, pay attention, this is what happens. But rather to draw people in, and in fact you'll see there's a strong public collaborative element to the project. So I'm gonna talk in a moment about the specific pilot the Thomas Wead film, and how it pointed to the challenges of working in such a collaborative manner with the public. As for the future, I've already, you know, kind of tipped my hand about this in terms of the paths we've gone down, the paths we're going down. So I'm still hoping that this pilot will inspire somebody. If anyone here has, you know, cash that they want to part with, I'm hoping that somewhere along the line we'll be able to make this thing work. And I have to say, I don't tend to be an overly optimistic person by nature, but I think this one might flow. And so I want to spend most of the time I have left to talk about the making of Thomas Wead. So in 2013, we set out using a wide variety of media in both French and English to seek out lost stories. That is what we described as not very well-known stories. The word lost can be used in various ways. From the public, limiting our call to the Montreal area to reduce the cost of making a pilot. But I think that the kind of methodology process that we came up with is fairly easily transportable to other regions of Canada. We received something like 40 stories, but the most compelling for the purpose of this project was brought to us by Janet McConnell, a retired teacher at the Mackay School for the Deaf. So the filming part is Jan's story. In the film, for those of you who've seen it, you can just ignore me for a second. I mean, there is no narrator. It's effectively a story being told through the eyes of the person who brought the story to us and the artist that she gave the story to. So Jan isn't deaf. More on this question later. Her parents were. I came to understand a term I'd never known before, children of deaf adults, and sometimes referred to in the deaf community, not always kindly, I'll come back to that, as CODAs, children of deaf adults. But she does say in the film that her first language was signing, which would of course make sense given that her parents were deaf. She always felt closely connected to the deaf community. She talked to us in interviews at great length about, you know, all the kind of her aunts and uncles that she saw were the members of the deaf community of her parents' generation. She went to outings, in fact, at school that I'll talk about in a moment, where her parents first met, and where she, and now her daughters, taught. But the story she really wanted to tell wasn't so much about the school per se, although the school figures large in the whole thing, but about the founder of the school, Thomas Wead, whose story was truly lost. An immigrant from England, Wead, deaf from his youth, came to Montreal in the 1860s and established a school for Protestant deaf children, which became known as the Mackay School for the Deaf in the 1870s when Joseph Mackay, a Montreal businessman, my office is actually on Mackay Street, provided the land and the money for the school that stood, this particular structure, which stood until the 1960s. And so Wead's story was lost. So if we were looking for a lost story, like, we couldn't have done a whole lot better. A deaf man whose story had, in a sense, been silenced. And her goal, it was actually kind of weird, when we first met her, she pulled a diary of hers off the shelves, which she had, with an entry from the day she retired, saying that one of her goals in retirement was to make Thomas Wead's story better known. And there we were. So I think, you know, in terms of our goals for the project, she was sort of the ideal storyteller. I think she comes across well in the film, and I've learned from now, having made, I guess, 4 documentary films, that if you don't like the people you're going to spend time with, you've got a problem, because people want to somehow relate to the people that they're watching. So in part, the story is Jan McConnell's story. But the point of the project was to make Wead's story better known, and to give the story over to an artist, in this case, Laylee Douglas, who's chosen out of a Montreal artist, chosen out of an open competition to make a piece of public art commemorating Thomas Wead. We put no restrictions particularly on her. She had her budget. I guess I naively figured that whatever she did would be okay. I guess it might not have worked out that way. I have to say the school, where the school that Wead founded, where the artwork was placed, you know, gave us pretty much carte blanche, although I guess it might have been some sort of art that she could have created that they would have hated. But none of those things ever happened.
Along the way, we found that some artists, I mentioned this to those of you who were here earlier, some of the artists who had nibbled at the commission backed off when they realized that they were going to have to show all their warts, their process, how sausage is made, so to speak, on screen, but Laylee had no problem about that. And so in the film, we see Laylee being, in a sense, literally given the story by Jan McConnell. This was kind of the idea that there would be a storyteller who would have a story they wanted to tell, who would be, in a sense, handing it off or working with, to some degree, an artist who would then make this story known. And what you see in the film, to a large extent, is Laylee trying to figure out how to do it, which, of course, was the whole point of the exercise, to denaturalize, if you will, the process of representing the past in public space. And so he had, so this is what, after they tore down that kind of, you know, Victorian building from the 19th century, this is what replaced it. And that was what she had to work with. That was her raw material. And if I could have a dollar for every conversation I had with her about how much she hated this site. But, you know, it didn't matter. But it didn't matter. That was sort of the point. This was the site that she was given. And I think this is a normal kind of way in which the past gets represented in public space, right? That there's a story that has to be told. There's a story that's going to be told. There's a kind of logical place where it would be constructed. And you have to deal with it. And so when we look at the object, we also have to take into account the constraints that were on the artist. And so Laylee's endless complaining, some of which we hear on film, were pertinent. Moreover, she puzzled over what particular form the historical marker should take. She had ideas about building a number of the small objects that you'll see when we come to what she actually did, that the whole idea of the school being home was prominent, in part because interviews that we did with people in the deaf community was always that the school was like a home. And so she had an idea she was going to build little houses, and she was going to distribute them throughout the site, until someone said this was a school that deals with children of a variety of disabilities, and putting little houses scattered across the site might not be good for their health and safety. And so that was the end of that idea. So again, having to work with the site she had, and beyond that, what story, in fact, to tell? In particular, she struggled how to communicate with deafness, and so went through a variety of things. Perhaps the most humorous, because she saw the humor in it, was her idea that she had some unique idea as a person of hearing, that she would somehow present his story through the use of signing in some way. Of course, she didn't know signing, and this had been done before, and she finally recognized that was kind of dumb. She laughs at herself in the film, you know, as being kind of naive. She struggled also with the issue of how abstract the art should be. I can tell you that the filmmaker, for the film part of the project, hated the art because it's very literal. But that was his problem. I just told him, make the film. But she felt a very strong, she might have done that, but after she spent time with the deaf community, which felt strongly about Wood's story being known, that creating a piece of abstract art wouldn't achieve that goal, that it needed to be told in a kind of straightforward, forthright way, at least that's what she felt. Okay, so in the end, the artwork that we inaugurated in the fall of 2013 tells Wood's journey literally from right to left here, starting in England, where he was born, going to Montreal, where he created the school, and ending in California, where he died. Along the way, focusing on Witt and his wife, who were the two original school teachers, the school that he created, and what it meant to the deaf community. And so in both French and English, this place was like home to us. The point of the project, though, was to ultimately show this story on film. And so if there's Jan McConnell's story and Laylee's story, there's also the story that was told by Bernard Hebert, the filmmaker, and I guess would be as the producer standing over his shoulder. There's Bernard standing just to the left of the camera. In the end, we wanted to show that there was a process of selection every point along the way. Laylee had to make choices. And in the end, for the project as it goes forward, it's important for us to show that there are also choices when you make a film like this. You know, it's 22 minutes long, there's stuff that's on screen, there's stuff that isn't on screen. And the website, that's a kind of beta version of what the project website might look like, includes material about Thomas Wood's life that's not in the film. To give you an example, we discovered in the research for the project that Wood was rather virulent, anti-Catholic, felt strongly that he was teaching children in order to help them be better Protestants. And there was nothing unusual about this in the time that he lived, that in mid-19th century Quebec, divisions between language groups, between religious groups, rather, were much stronger than between language groups. And yet, for all of that, what did we have to tell the story for? We chose not to tell the story. In the film, somebody might say, you know, why did we censor? That wasn't the story we wanted to tell, but I certainly encourage people to think about the fact that whenever we represent the past, there's a process of selection. And so, you know, in the project more broadly, there's the question of, you know, what stories get chosen, how they get represented through the public art, and even at the level of film, I mean, there's choices about, you know, what you show. It isn't as if what you show is the only film that could have been made. Okay, so I'm going to close by reflecting briefly on the making of Thomas Wood. And since this is a conference that's interested in exploring the challenges and connecting with the larger public, I thought I'd reflect on the project as it goes to its next phase. So what stood out for me in doing this, so in Michelle's introduction, I guess nothing came out in that I somehow was an expert on the history of the deaf community. And what I realized was that I was sort of, so the films I made before all grew out of my own research. So I kind of knew what I was dealing with, and what became clear to me almost immediately after we got so excited about making this film about the deaf community was that I knew very little about the deaf community, that I was an outsider, and suddenly here I was trying to tell the deaf community's story. And so the challenges, which I think ultimately I think were confronted appropriately, was to learn the identity politics within the deaf community. There's very strong and distinctive politics within the deaf community, motivated, mobilized to a large degree because the deaf community is one in danger of disappearing, as some within the community would put it. Many of the diseases that cause deafness no longer are a problem, and the cochlear implant has made it possible for large numbers of children who might have been deaf to be hearing. There are those in the deaf community, this is a longer discussion, you know, who would not see this as entirely positive, because there had been, you know, a strong, flourishing deaf community with its own culture, which is now in danger. And so telling Thomas Wood's story within that particular kind of political moment was a challenge. In the film, you see very few deaf children. That's the reality of the situation today. And so no one ever challenged my right, if that's the right way of putting it, to tell that story. But in the context of the decline of the deaf populations, there were questions raised. And certainly in screening the film, there was an interesting discussion. For instance, the role of the children of deaf adults. So Jan McConnell, a child of deaf adults, but not a deaf person herself, being the storyteller, was troubling for some people in the deaf community. You know, my feeling about that was, of course, others could have brought us the story. She's the one that did bring us the story. And yet, you know, I think it's a point in a way that when you come in cold in a way like we did, that I hadn't quite expected. There's in the film, what you're going to see in the little clip we're going to see in a moment, and you saw earlier, there's one of the teachers with kind of wild white hair. She also is a coda, a child of deaf adults. So again, the point was made, you know, why this prominent kind of position for these codas, a term that I don't think is always meant as a compliment. Also, the question of signing in the film. Questions were asked about the extent to which people signed to be able to express themselves. So one of the people in the deaf community who kind of, you know, really feels like Thomas Wood is hers, is shown signing, but she also had been educated in an oral school, and so she speaks while she signs. So the point was made, well, you know, people can understand her. We didn't subtitle her because you can understand her, I think, perfectly well. And so again, the question was raised, well, no one is prominently displayed in the film who is only signing. So all of this to say that there was a full and frank discussion with certain members of the deaf community after the film was shown.
And I think, like many collaborative projects, what you develop relationships and collaborations evolve over time. And what happened in this case is that one of the more vocal, animated members of the deaf community, Pamela Witcher, who you're going to see in a moment, was somewhat critical of the film, but at the same time wanted Thomas Wood's story to be told. And you'll see there's an American Sign Language version of the film, and Pamela is the signer. So in a way, the end of the story is that, when you work with communities, you just keep at it, recognize, potholes you might have missed, and try to bring people in. And moreover, I can tell you that this mural that you'll see in a moment that Lely Douglas built on the site is now in danger because this current ugly school, the one that you can see back here, is now in danger of being torn down and the site being sold, which has raised an interesting question that I find myself in the middle of as to what happens to the artwork. And so I'm now getting email messages and phone calls from people in the deaf community who now look to me as somehow, being part of it, which is a good thing, right? Because I think it indicates that through all of this, some kind of collaboration has been done. Okay, so for those who haven't seen what I've just been yakking about for the last 18 minutes or so, So this is the last 3 minutes of the film with Pamela Witcher, the person who I was somewhat critical of some aspects of the film, doing the ESL signing.
Okay, well, good morning, everyone.
Thank you very much. As Michelle mentioned in her introduction, Julia and I are PhD candidates at Trent University. Julia studies women and working class history in Canada, and I study the history of education and colonialism in Western Canada. But today we're here representing the Graphic History Collective, or the GHC. The GHC is a group of activists, artists, writers, and researchers passionate about comics, history, and social change. In our talk today, Julie and I are going to expand on the exhibit we have up in the King Mills Room by explaining how we see our work as members of the Graphic History Collective as active or activist history. To ground our conversation in a concrete example, we're going to talk about the comics that will be appearing in the GHC's forthcoming publication, Drawn to Change, History, Graphic Histories of Working Class Struggle. I'll be starting by providing a brief history of the tradition of activist comics and explain how the Graphic History Collective fits into that tradition. Julia will then discuss how the comics in Drawn to Change were created and how they remind us that history can serve as an important resource for contemporary struggles for social change. While the origins of the comic book are debatable, it is generally agreed that the mixture of words and sequential art, often taking the form of different panels on a printed page, emerged as a distinct artistic medium in the late 19th century. Inspired by the political cartoons of European newspapers, artists in America began creating comics for Sunday editions of newspapers in the early 20th century. By the 1930s, these strips, referred to as comics because they were often humorous, were being bound together and sold separately in a distinct magazine format. For the most part, people considered early comics to be light comical diversions for the serious issues of the day. Yet comics also had dissident dimensions, as some comic strips and graphic books combined the new medium of illustrated sequential art with radical politics. One of the first labor comics, Ernest Ribb's Mr. Block, published by the Industrial Workers of the World in the 1910s, poked fun at the proverbial patriotic, law-abiding, and anti-union blockhead, and this character even inspired Joe Hill to write the well-known labor song, Mr. Block, which you can find online if you're interested. There were also many standalone graphic books published in the 1930s and 1940s. Many of them were wordless but sequential linocuts with explicitly left politics, including Prelude to a Million Years and White Collar. These are extremely hard to, Lynn Ward's work you can find, but White Collar is very difficult to track down today. By the late 1930s, comics had become an established medium, primarily for children and adolescents, but with some popular and political appeal for adults as well. It was the invention of the superhero in the late 1930s and early 1940s, however, specifically the creation of first Superman and then Batman, that launched the comic book into the mainstream. During World War II, new comic book superheroes such as Captain America and Wonder Woman played a key role in American military propaganda, and consequently, comic books reached new heights of popularity. Anxious adults, however, began to argue that comics, and specifically crime comics, were too violent and even dangerous and subversive. And in the post-war period, they began to challenge the medium's legitimacy. In the face of Cold War pressures and tighter regulations on the production and distribution of comics, which led to things like the Comics Code, which I can talk about in the questions, some producers refused to sacrifice the social relevance of their work, and so they chose to create and distribute their art independently. Writers and illustrators kept alive a dissident spirit in comics as they forged an underground comics with an X movement, which overlapped with broader countercultural scenes in the United States and the UK in the 1960s and 1970s. As the youth of the post-war period reached adulthood and the intensity of the Cold War faded, it became clear that they had not abandoned their love for comics. And it was in this kind of moment that the modern graphic novel was born. Drawing on the themes and styles of the underground comics movement, such new projects as Will Eisner's The Contract with God and Alan Moore's Watchmen were published to rave reviews. But it was Art Spiegelman's Mouse that permanently altered the literary landscape. Just by a show of hands, how many people have read or come across Mouse? So quite a few people. Spiegelman's historical account of Nazism and the horrors of the Holocaust became a bestseller. It won a Pulitzer Prize in 1992 and firmly established the graphic novel as capable of capturing the attention of traditional comic book fans, as well as those seeking more critical and serious engagements with both history and politics. Since then, comics have experienced an incredible mainstream resurgence. Superhero films are making millions at the box office, and comics are even becoming bestsellers. Moreover, because of this popularity, more progressive comics are being published, and publishers are taking risks on these comics. And these new works are carrying the tradition of activist comics to new levels. Since 2000, new comics have highlighted the lives of such figures as Emma Goldman and Louis Riel, and looked at historical issues such as the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and indigenous resistance throughout the Americas, just to name a few. The activist comics of the early 2000s greatly inspired the formation of the Graphic History Collective. The origins of the GHC trace back to the mid-2000s, when a group of historians associated with the Canadian Committee on Labor History answered a call from the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada for innovative research projects that would bring together nationwide clusters of research expertise. The group submitted a proposal to create awareness about Canadian labor and working class history through the publication of popular and accessible materials, including a comic book. The problem was that nobody actually knew how to create a comic book. That's where the GHC came into being. After Shirk agreed to fund the project, Mark Lear, a history professor at Simon Fraser University, took on the task of assembling a research, writing, and illustrating team that eventually became the GHC. The team, having little prior experience with the comic medium itself, worked together to produce a comic book about the history of May Day, or International Workers' Day, on May 1st, as it's celebrated in Canada. After selling over 2,000 copies of that first project, May Day, a Graphic History of Protest, the GHC partnered with Between the Lines Press in Toronto to release a revised edition in 2012 and an ebook in 2013. To date, over 5,000 copies of May Day have been sold to teachers, unions, and social justice groups interested in comics and history. Though the GHC initially formed only to create the May Day comic book, most of us were just volunteers, members soon began to dream of new projects. In the fall of 2012, the GHC made an open call for proposals to start a new endeavor called the Graphic History Project. We wanted to share our skills and knowledge of how to make comics with others. We hope to encourage new comics writers and illustrators to come together to produce, again on a volunteer basis, a number of short graphic histories that illustrated the ways people from a diversity of backgrounds have struggled for social justice. Once completed, the finished comics would be made available on our website and then potentially collected, edited, and published with a Progressive Press. Proposals quickly flooded our inbox, and in 2013, we started working with established comics producers, as well as illustrators, writers, and researchers that had never created a comic book before. As each project was completed, it was posted on the GHC website, and in total, 12 comics were created. Most of them were about 10 pages. Some of them were as long as 30 pages. Projects examined different subjects, ranging from the 19th century French feminist Suzanne Vauquin and Portland's Black Panthers, to the history of the environmental movement, and the 1936 sit-down strike in Flint, Michigan. The vast majority of projects, however, focused on various aspects of Canadian working class and labor history. From the movements like the Knights of Labor, to the lives of activists like Madeleine Perrant, to the protests like the Days of Action in Ontario in the 1990s. As the Graphic History Project wound down, we realized that a collection of graphic histories focused specifically on working class struggles in Canada would be an important contribution to Canadian history and to the tradition of activist comics. The result is Drawn to Change, that Julia is now going to talk a little bit more about.
Thanks, Sean. The Drawn to Change collection will feature 9 comics that were completed as part of the Graphic History Project. And as Sean said, they range in length from 10 to 30 pages. And all of them highlight different aspects of Canadian labor history. So as you're going to see in some of the sample pages I'll show you today and that you can view in the King's Mill Room, the history of working class struggle in Canada is a fascinating story of conflict, coercion, resistance, and triumph. But working class history is not just interesting and exciting. It also contains important lessons that we can learn from and use to change the world today. As a whole, the comics in the collection showcase the courage and determination of workers who fought to bring about a better world. In fact, one of the central aims of the GHC's work is to combine comics and activist history to emphasize the importance of hope. In this regard, we take our inspiration from historian and activist Howard Zinn, who argues, quote, To be hopeful in bad times is not just foolishly romantic. It is based on the fact that human history is a history not only of cruelty, but also of compassion, sacrifice, courage, and kindness, end hope, end quote. So to encourage hope, Drawn to Change offers inspiring histories of working class struggle in a short and easy to read format. We don't have time today to discuss all of the comics in the collection, so I'll just talk about a few to help explain the collection's contributions to active history. The first comic in the collection is produced by the GHC and focuses on the noble and holy order, it's a mouthful, of the Knights of Labor, an influential 19th century labor organization. The GHC produced this comic book as the first in the Graphic History Project series to show other teams what we were hoping to create. We shared our storyboard with the teams as something of a template to help them get started on their own projects, and we posted the final comic on our website to show people what a finished product might look like. We also included a bibliography that listed the sources we consulted to produce the project. And it also included the historical photos that inspired some of the imagery. Oftentimes the artists didn't know about the topic, so they would say, can you send us some photos to get a sense of the topic? So in this way, we really did try to blend historical research with the writing and medium of comics. Dreaming of What Might Be, the Knights of Labor in Canada 1880 to 1900, shows how in the process of constructing Canada as a capitalist settler society, the state dispossessed Indigenous peoples from their lands and pushed many people into the cities to work in factories. Working conditions in cities such as Toronto and Hamilton were often poor, and by mid-century, workers started to organize to fight back. By the 1880s, the Knights of Labor, which was founded in Philadelphia in 1869 as one of the first labor organizations in North America, had come to Canada. The Knights of Labor appealed to workers because it asked them, regardless of skill, sex, or race, to dream of what might be, rather than accept the poor conditions that were said to be unchangeable at the time. These lessons are important to remember in our current moment, when we so often hear there is no alternative. So with this comic then, our aim was to show how members created a culture that offered people hope and mobilized workers to fight for social change. So the GHC also believes that it's important to strive for diversity in the histories we highlight and to create space within the comics medium for women and racialized artists and writers. In fact, the majority of the artists featured in Drawn to Change are female, and if anyone here knows anything about the comics industry, that's very, very unusual. Working on the water, fighting for the land, Indigenous labor on Burrard Inlet is a case in point. So the comic was produced by Tanya Willard and GHC members Robin Fulvick and Sean Carleton. And it highlights, it looks at Indigenous people's long history of work. The project shows how Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Coast Salish First Nations peoples in what is now known as British Columbia responded to the coming of colonialism and capitalism in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Working on the Water relies on transcripts of oral interviews with Indigenous laborers to demonstrate how Indigenous peoples worked on the waterfront and use the benefits of unionization to help fund their efforts to protect their lands and how they continue to do so today. Overall, the project highlights the strength, creativity, and resilience of Coast Salish peoples, both past and present, and showcases the work of Tanya, who is a prominent female Indigenous artist in Canada. Working on the Water was featured recently in Active History, and Tanya has an exhibit on right now at the Workers' Arts and Heritage Center in Hamilton, with panels from this comic book. And as a side note, just for this conference, the Workers' Arts and Heritage Center actually does really great active history, and I encourage those of you who have not checked out their work to do so. So in producing Drawn to Change, we also had the chance to collaborate with international artists, including Ethan Heitner. Ethan is an editor with World War III in New York, one of the most significant alternative comics publications in the world. So Ethan wanted to work as part of a team to produce a comic book for the Graphic History Project, and he was eager to try something new, taking on a topic about which he knew very little. He decided to partner with the GHC to produce a comic book based on some of my own research on a feminist labor union, the Service Office and Retail Workers Union of Canada, or SORWOC. All of the work for this comic, storyboarding, the drafting, the editing, the revising, was done over Skype and email. And in fact, this is true for most of the comics in the collection. In, I think, the vast majority of cases, the writers and illustrators work together and they've actually never met face to face, so it was all done online. So in terms of this comic, Sorowak was formed in Vancouver in the early 1970s, and in contrast to many of the established mainstream business unions of the time, they were small, independent, and grassroots, and committed to improving the lives of working women through a diversity of tactics, including direct action. As a smaller union that sought to organize low-paid office and service workers, the success of Sorowak depended to a great extent on engaged members and community solidarity. Ultimately, the Sorowak comic book shows us the importance of democratic and feminist labor organizing, as well as the need to challenge business unionism and the state's role in labor relations. And one interesting thing to note about this comic is that Sorowak themselves actually used a lot of comic imagery in their flyers and educational materials. They were inspired by the Industrial Workers of the World that Sean referred to earlier with the Mr. Block comic. And in producing some of the artwork for this, for example, this image at the very top, and if you see the panels that are in the King's Mill Room, Ethan actually used archival documents produced by the union, so it's very cool, again, combining the historical archival research with comics. Okay, the final project in the collection is Kwentong Bayan Labor of Love, which is by Althea Balms and Joe Simalaya Alcampo. This comic book examines the real-life stories of Filipino migrant workers in the Canadian Live-In Caregiver Program. And this is just 10 pages. They are actually working on a much longer comic book that'll be a standalone one under the same title, Kwentong Bayan. So definitely encourage you to check it out when it's out. This project differs from the others in Drawn to Change in that it was produced in close collaboration with caregivers and supporters. So in that sense, it's a great example of the community-engaged research that we've been talking about at this conference. So it highlights the work experiences of caregivers and showcases their stories of community, friendship, love, struggle, and empowerment. Balms and Alcampo demonstrate how government policy intersects with workers' daily lives, and how even the most vulnerable and precarious workers can find meaning and dignity in their paid work. In the Filipino language, Kwentong Bayan means community stories. Labor of Love reflects Balms and Alcampo's understanding that community-based artwork and caregiving work are rooted in love, are valuable, and deserve respect. So to conclude, overall, what emerges from the Drawn to Change collection is a clear picture of the strength and perseverance of working people in the face of different kinds of adversity. The individual stories, though, only offer readers snapshots of a more fluid and complicated history of working class struggle in Canada. The histories of this collection span more than 150 years, cover many geographic areas, and discuss a variety of people, events, and struggles. But they are in no way meant to be representative of Canadian labor history as a whole. Given that we started with an open call for submissions, much is missing, and many more comics need to be created. So we encourage people to get involved and to work with others to produce comics to fill in the gaps. For now, though, we hope Drawn to Change generates new interest in activist comics and working class history, and that it shows people the importance of learning from the past, using it as a resource to help guide present and future struggles for social justice. Thanks.
So I'm just going to hand out some postcards, so feel free, or just pass them around. Feel free to take one or two. There's a bunch of different kinds, and I will explain what those are about in the course of this. So my paper is about two art projects that I've completed, and one I'll be doing based on the first two, all of which intersect with the practice of doing history in some way. So I'm actually relatively new to history. My background is in anthropology, which has its own interesting links to art, and I'm now in the Canadian Studies PhD at Trent. But even before I started the PhD, I became fascinated with the way in which history is done in the university, but also how it's understood and mobilized outside of the university in the community. So I'm interested specifically, and this is because this also came up in my research in anthro, in how the myth of objectivity persists, or so I would argue, even when apparently the majority of academics no longer believe it to be the case. So with these history slash art projects that I did, I basically wanted to ask the question, what is making this possible? What conditions are making it possible for this understanding of history as objective record to persist in certain communities? So I, in essence, designed a couple of art projects to do some tests. Social scientist that I am, I guess. So at the time of the projects, I also was not actually a student, but was working at Art Space, which is an artist-run center in Peterborough, which is first and foremost a gallery. So this, of course, fueled the direction that these projects took. As I wasn't immersed in the academic history world at the time as I am now, but in the art world, which has very different priorities and influences. So the most overt influence on the first project I completed, and I'll explain them all in sequence, was a 2008 poster project by a Vancouver-based artist, Michael Joubert, which he called Available Light. So the poster, which he put up around Vancouver, was all about potentiality. So it's the potential of this action to take place, underscored by its ambiguity and the lack of any concrete location or time. So as the exhibition stated, quote, Available Light functions as a catalyst, one that has positive as well as potentially dangerous aspects. As the exact location, time, and scope of the fire the artist will attempt to produce will be unknown, the gesture takes on both a romantic and saboteur-like feel, rife with associations. The potential destruction under Barrett's gesture is as strong as the potential of hope, end quote. So I actually ended up staring at a reproduction of this poster quite frequently as it was taped on the wall above the toilet at Art Space. So the idea took place in my mind of doing something similar in Peterborough, which is, I think, a city full of unrealized potential. So the second main influence on my first project was the documentary film My Winnipeg by Canadian filmmaker Guy Madden, which is an excellent film, and I really encourage you to check it out. I think it's on Netflix. He describes the film as a docu-fantasia, which is, according to him, a curious blend of fact and fiction, weaving together stories and memories of his childhood with the history of the city. So I think that the film creates a doubt in the viewer's mind about what's true and what isn't, but through this also attempts to get at some other kind of truth. This is perhaps what the filmmaker Werner Herzog calls ecstatic truth. Herzog says that fact creates norms and truth illumination. He differentiates between the two, saying facts are for accountants, and that truth can only be achieved through fabrication, imagination, and stylization. I think that the Canadian novelist Michael Winter similarly describes this process as making up sets of facts that convey the truth of things. So the Available Light poster in Madden's film My Winnipeg gave me a model on which to build. The concrete medium in the form of the poster, using a blend of so-called fact and fiction, basically as different as it could get from the historical plaques that you often find throughout, especially small towns. So I created what I called simply History Project, a series of 8 posters that I put up around Peterborough in a variety of locations, some conventional, some quite odd, during the summer of 2014. And it's these posters that are also part of the project down the hall. So most of these posters were actually taken down almost immediately, as far as I can tell. Some are washed away in a rainstorm that claimed the first batch several hours after I put them up. I should have checked the weather better. But many of them stayed up for weeks, and I even came across some social media posts. So the one on the right is actually in the Trent University paper that's published, and I have a couple other here with media posts as well. But because they are anonymous, it was really hard to track their movements. And everything I heard about them afterwards was usually through word of mouth. So the main question I heard about them naturally was, are they true? But by the end of the project, I found this question kind of irrelevant, as it was never necessarily my purpose to portray a 100% factually true story, whatever that would even entail depending on people's definitions. I would say that the stories are all based on historical fact, or at least inspired by it, with some kind of imaginative modification. Although a couple of them I would also say are pretty well verbatim. In essence, I would say that they all could be true. So I made the poster specifically to straddle that divide and essentially create doubt in the reader, both about the story itself, but also about the conventions of historical writing and the authority of the practice. So the second project I did builds on these posters. It was done as part of Arts Week, which is a city-funded annual arts festival in Peterborough. I worked with another artist, Andrea Catellis, to make a historical walking tour with some twists. But essentially, we made use of the format of walking tours like the ones that I assume took place last night. And that's what the postcards are. They are all examples of some of the stops along the tour. And you'll notice that there are people's addresses on the back. I meant to mail those out, but I got really sidetracked. So I invite you to mail them if you want to and become a part of this process. It would be excellent. So we used the conventions of the walking tour, but subverted them in certain ways. The map that we produced had numbers corresponding to all the locations in town, but all the descriptions of the stops were riddles, forcing the walking tourists to decipher them in order to figure out what they were actually meant to be looking at. And most of the time, nothing actually remained to look at, because, like with the poster project, most of the artifacts disappeared hours after we put them there. And in truth, some of them actually looked like garbage that was just strewn along the road. So even if they remained, people probably wouldn't necessarily have realized that's what the stop was. But they are meant to be ephemeral and impermanent. And so they often just disappeared. But similarly, the project was meant to interrogate the value of history and what I would call the service of community enrichment in some way, and to draw attention to these conventions of historical writing and deployment in the community. And what's particularly interesting about this iteration of the project, I think, was the jury process. So the project was submitted to Arts Week, which then weighted against other projects because it's first and foremost an art show, an exhibition. We actually got some funding to make this, which I find really funny. But there was apparently some debate about the project by the jury itself. And I know this because Peterborough is a really small place with no secrets. So I found out that one of the jury members, who apparently is a Parks Canada employee, was vehemently opposed to this project. The person thought that it was dishonest and liable to cause harm to those attempting to understand it and just have a good time during the week taking the tour. And I should say that Arts Week is not necessarily known for its history of really good critical work. Like any municipally funded project, or at least arts project, there are certain parameters that have to usually be met, which is mainly that it's accessible, family-friendly, and inoffensive. Nevertheless, we got money. And I think that's mostly due to the advocacy of another member of the jury who actually had a PhD in history and thought that it was an interesting experiment, all of which seems really ironic to me in some way. So the third project I'll mention has yet to be produced, but we'll build on these last two, mostly because I haven't gotten any money for that one yet. And it's interesting to also be presenting on that when I haven't made it, because that's kind of odd, but at the same time feels somewhat appropriate given the nature of these other projects. For the project, I essentially plan to make a podcast based on these stories and posters in the style of them, and inspired by the format of Welcome to Night Vale, which is a popular podcast in the style of community updates for this fictional small desert town in the States. And the updates are generally bizarre and supernatural in nature. And as they describe it, the podcast features, quote, local weather, news, announcements from the sheriff's secret police, mysterious lights in the night sky, dark hooded figures with unknowable powers, and cultural events, end quote. So the podcast will feature a voiceover telling the history of Peterborough, of its people, its institutions, notable events and buildings, but all in the way in which I did these history posters in the walking tour. So it'll be a mix of voice and archival audio material I find, which may or may not be from Peterborough, but with the intention, again, of creating doubt in the listener, of unsettling this boundary between fact and fiction, if it really exists, and just trying to get at some kind of other truth or illumination, which at the end of the day, for me, I think is something that better reflects really the weirdness of everyday life and history, and that's especially true in Peterborough, if you've ever been there. So with these projects, my intention has been to explore the conventions of history, of actually doing it and what its effects are in the community. But to be honest, I don't necessarily know what those effects are, and this is largely a result of the nature of the projects. They were designed to be totally anonymous and ephemeral, and so they're really hard to track. And I didn't, for some reason, I had a sense of that before I did it, but I didn't realize how difficult that would be, I guess. But I do have some indications of the effects that they had. So most of the people I talked to knew that they weren't necessarily entirely true, but never knew for sure exactly what part of the story were untrue. So the posters on the tour, I think, at the end, created the doubt that I was going for, which I was quite happy about. However, others I talked to did take them as literal truth, and there are quite a few people I talked to who thought that they were totally verbatim from the archives or something. They couldn't discern any falsehood in them, and actually talked to a few people who started to pass those stories on to others as part of just the general Peterborough lore, which I was super psyched about as well. But it's that reaction in particular that I think reinforced my questions about objectivity and historical authority. So considering the format of the posters I used, I literally wrote them with a Sharpie and then just photocopied them, and then put them up around town anonymously. I wondered what it was about that format that made people actually believe them, because it's so different from the historical plaque one. I purposely used this format that I thought in some ways was fundamentally opposed to that historical plaque, because they're usually, these plaques are sanctioned by the government, by the municipality, and are backed up by historians with authority in some way. Yet even so, some people believe my posters anyway. And to be honest, one of my main motivations coming from the art world for this was mischief, of playing around with these stories to make local history more interesting and dynamic. And I don't think it wasn't malicious in any way, I just wanted to make them more interesting. But I didn't necessarily think that anyone would really believe them. I just wanted that doubt there. So the kind of the general framework that I've been working with for this that came after doing the project actually, I think is best provided by Emily Cameron in her recent book, Far Off Metal River, which is about the legacy of the so-called Bloody Falls massacre in 1771 in the Arctic, and how it's become a kind of settler shorthand for the beginning of history in Canada. And that's the quote for her. So in the book, she defines storytelling as a relational and material ordering practice. So stories are not necessarily ephemeral after all. They're not just words used to convey a feeling or some kind of inferior oral tradition, but rather have real material effects on our lives. So my projects try to make sense of this by attempting to provoke a response that demonstrates this material effect by interrogating in whatever small way the conventions of historical writing and dissemination. They are essentially meant to intervene in people's lives, to bring history into their daily activities and make them think about the place in which they live. So like the available light posters earlier, I was trying to make mine a catalyst for something, whatever that happened to be. And my favorite feedback about the projects was from someone who told me that after reading the posters and trying out the tour, they simply thought that the projects conveyed a sense of Peterborough as a city that has been lived in. A city that in fact has a history, which I think was interpreted by this person differently than would have been in a typical academic sense. I also think that some people, for example, that Parks Canada employee, have thought that I was playing fast and loose with history, in exaggerating and reimagining some of these stories and histories. But I think that it's first disingenuous to assume that we can tell history objectively, and that's come up again in this conference over and over, that archives provide some kind of taken for granted reading of past events. It's all a process of selection and interpretation. And I think that history needs to always expand outward and take on new linkages with other disciplines or ways of doing things, especially with art, even though that might not seem like the natural connection at first. And so maybe the call for this kind of reflexivity and the relevance of the discipline is a tired refrain, but at the same time, if I've learned nothing else from my background in anthro, all of these things are performances. Culture needs to be done again and again, and these performances need to be reinscribed again and again in order to have relevance. And so I'm hoping with these projects and the little twist on them that I tried out, I'm successful at doing this project in some small way. And at the very least, I just wanted to get people on the street to stop for a second and wonder at why the poster they're reading seems so weird. And then perhaps that will drive them to reflect on what history means to them and why it matters to them to have their place in their lives. Thank you.
If I can ask all four presenters to move over to the chairs there. Comments and questions? Yes,
I had a question for Ronald, although maybe you want to sort of add on, go for it. I was wondering, you discussed sort of some of the challenges that came up making the film or afterwards and dealing with community representatives and things like that. And I was wondering if you had to make the film all over again, if you would include some of that stuff in the film to sort of show that the process not only of making the art, but the process of having the art there.
So, you mean showing the showing the complications of working with the community?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Well, okay, to answer the what I thought was the first question, I think, so the challenge was that working on a tight time frame, made the long-term, so the reality was making the long-term work that we know is crucial to doing collaborative projects with communities, takes years. And I think the reality was that this crew and this project couldn't, in a way, wait for all of that. So, I'm sort of, in other parts of my professional practice, if I could put it that way, I wouldn't have done it as quickly. And those, some of those potholes would have been avoided. And yet, given the nature of the particular exercise, I'm not sure how all of it could have been avoided. Maybe, and I'm not sure it should have been avoided. So, the internal politics of the deaf community about quotas, people told me on the side, that they weren't real, comfortable about that. But being the reality, from another perspective was, but those were the people who brought us the story, right? I sort of had no control over, or people said, well, you didn't have a deaf artist. Well, we had an open competition to the Montreal arts community, which includes a number of deaf artists. I mean, if they wanted to do the art, they sort of asked the question. So I recognize all of that. Whether it could have been the film, well, this is a question of who your audience is, which is a question that came up before. Like, I was really trying to make, my thinking about the project is it's something that could be seen by a group different than this group. So if I was only making the film for this group, I would say definitely, because the process would be interesting to this group. I'm not sure at some point, you get so deep into describing the process that it then changes the nature of the thing. But, as the project goes forward, and there's, if you think about the website, for instance, as an opportunity to show aspects that aren't in the film, that could be a place, to again play on, how the selection process took place, and maybe, other content could be included.
Thank you.
Yes.
A question for Sean and Julia. I was just wondering if there's any reflection on the decision behind the artwork in your comics in terms of black and white versus color, hand-drawn versus digital, or even a discussion about how the comic looks and then what that conveys about the message and the history.
I guess the short answer is that we wanted each artist and team to talk about their artistic style. So every artist has their own kind of perspective and how they prefer to draw images. Some of them do it digitally, some of them still do it by hand. A lot of the conversation, the only guidance I suppose that we gave was that one of the new things in comics is challenging the whiteness of comics. So as Julia was saying, our commitment to make space in comics, the only kind of artistic stipulation that we asked is that in creating these kinds of works, that you don't just have the kind of whiteness be the kind of general. So if you're having crowd shots, for example, don't just draw your figure and leave the whiteness of the panel to stand. We wanted to kind of challenge that. Other than that, it was an open, free will for them to do whatever they wanted. And I think the diversity of styles is reflected in the collection, because other than Sam Brad, who did two of the comics, all of the styles are very different.
And I think even on the race aspect too, so the Quentin Bayan one, that one's produced by Filipino artists, the ones who worked in collaboration with Filipino characters, and I'm pretty sure if I recall all their panels, they made the decision about the white space, and I think they left that, right? So even though they were drawing racialized, they themselves are coming from a racialized community, they're drawing racialized workers, they chose to stick with more or less the white space. So we did give artists, we would engage in discussions, but we didn't ultimately say, like, no, you have to do it this way. And that's one of the challenges of working collaboratively. Like, one of the things I've noticed going throughout this whole conference is we could have done a whole conference just on working collaboratively and the challenges that that entails. But it's, I think in the end, you learn so much and it's worth it. But even just things like the digital aspect too, you'll notice some of them were hand-drawn, the text, and some used computer input, right? So there was a real mix of people's perspectives and tools they used.
And the aesthetics of those choices. I mean, one of the things that in Tanya's comic, she did a lot of lino cuts, and we went back and forth on how she would do the text. And because, to not get into it too much, but there's lots of kind of revision that goes back and forth on the storyboard. She was very reticent to kind of lino cut the words, because then they really couldn't be changed back. So we decided to go with it. She would do the lino cut and then would do the digital text on top of it, which aesthetically I wasn't the biggest fan of, but she was really kind of showing how that was really necessary in terms of that kind of work. So I mean, these are about, collaborative projects are about conversations and you kind of give and take, and you kind of, it comes together in weird sorts of ways.
Yes,
Mathew, I really enjoyed your presentation, and I'm in the process of discussing historical plaques in one of the towns where I work, and you just made me so excited about how to subvert that whole
thing.
I was just wondering if you had, your project was deliberately ephemeral, but I was just wondering if you had the chance to do something that wasn't ephemeral, what would you do?
I've honestly never thought of that. Maybe that's a result of my resistance against that kind of stuff, but it's interesting that the first thing that comes to mind is actually from Ronald's presentation. I would probably make a monument to myself as an ironic thing. And I'm thinking of Douglas Copeland's recent show in Vancouver. He put his head cast in bronze, stuck it on the street, and invited people to stick gum onto it. And by the end, it was disgusting. It was just a disgusting piece of gum, but I thought it was just brilliant. You know? And making something more permanent like that, that is, like, I think it just really needs to also subvert the idea of permanence, right? So it's, in some way, that would be really cool.
It occurred to me that all of your work is about kind of identifying gaps in the historical narrative and then using art to help fill those gaps. Using works of art in one way or another to convey history obviously has its own, is fraught with its own kind of complexities and problems. Did you find that difficult? Were there specific kind of obstacles that you encountered in using that kind of media, or was it pretty much a natural decision?
Thanks.
No, it's not natural. For me, the issue always has been that, you know, I worked in text for so long that, you know, you're always fighting against the tendency to tell stories the way that you did, you know, in earlier lives. So natural, no, but I recognized a long time ago that there's a limit to, you know, the audience you can reach. I mean, I'm happy with the audience I can reach when I write, but that's limited. And it tells stories in a certain kind of way. And I think, you know, I guess in the films that I made, you know, there are no narrators, and the other people get to speak. And inevitably, when we write, you know, the best we can do is we're quoting them. But I mean, it's kind of their words speaking through our mouths. And, you know, the cool thing for me, you know, has been to use this other medium where, I mean, well, they're kind of speaking through my mouth, right? You don't see me doing it. But that's kind of the liberation of it in a way, right? That you have an opportunity to let people be seen as speaking. However, I mean, they're being edited, we're choosing the shot, there are all those things that you don't see. So, I mean, it's a bit disingenuous to say that they're speaking. And yet, at the same time, I think you know what I mean, that, you know, you're actually seeing them, you're making a connection with them. I don't, you know, in a way that I don't think that people often make a connection with the people that we collaborate with in our writing. So it provided a different kind of way to tell stories.
Yeah, I think picking up on that, I think the number one challenge is the writing. I think many of the writers that we deal with, just because several of us are grad students, is learning to write less. and that's challenging, I think, for academics especially, right? I mean, oftentimes it would be removing words and artists saying, why would you write this when I can draw this in such a more evocative manner? So I think learning to write less. And then also the pushback we received from, again, academics largely about kind of this is like watering down history or simplification of history. How can you possibly tell a complex, sorry, now overwhelmingly people have been supportive. I'm not trying to say that all academics have been hostile, but the way we have gotten pushback, that's been it. Like, how can you possibly tell a complicated story about, you know, the living caregiver program in a 10-page comic? And I guess I'll let you jump in, but we don't see it as watered down or simplified. To me, again, it's a different medium and it's a different way of presenting a story. Obviously, you're not going to present it the exact same way as you would in a 20-page scholarly footnoted article, but you're also reaching a different audience than you would with that kind of writing.
Yeah, just to briefly piggyback on that. I mean, I think one of the things that's really interesting about comics is that people think of it as a genre, but it's actually, we were talking about this in the car on the way over, it's actually a medium. And learning to understand how the medium works is, I think, part of the beauty of comics, because you're actually suggesting things and allowing the reader to make those connections based on the suggestions. So the text is sort of like a prompt, and the image is supposed to create new meaning in the context of the kind of words and images playing off each other, in a way that other kinds of mediums are a bit more straightforward. The comics medium creates deliberately these gaps in knowledge that the reader has to piece together to make meaning. And I think teaching writers that don't really understand how that medium works, I mean, they just want to, I have an article, I want to put some illustrations with it. So you kind of have to work with people to kind of learn how to build in some of that nuance and allow those gaps in knowledge to be a good thing rather than something to be feared.
I think it was probably more natural for me to use art because I'm a practicing filmmaker and artist anyway. But I think it also comes back to the audience, the same thing, and that I actually rarely like kind of bring this kind of stuff into the academic side. I usually keep it totally separate. And now it was a conscious choice after a painful process of doing films for my BA and MA and not film production programs and finding that it was really, really difficult to make that work, so I just separated that practice altogether. Once in a while, I do something like this. But yeah, like using art, I mean, I find art practice in many ways even more rigorous than doing history, for instance. Like my PhD is going to be done very quite traditionally, you know, working in the archives, that kind of thing. But I find that in conscious way easy. Not easy, but like in many ways, art is really friggin' hard to do and to make it interesting and relevant. I'm not saying that that's good art either. I think my walking tour failed really miserably. To me, it comes back to audience. Like, most of the time when I make this stuff, it's not for an active audience. So doing art is fine because that's no one is looking for something different. So I just, before I do any projects, especially with films and this kind of stuff, I'm just really, really clear on what the audience is going to be before you make it. And sometimes that changes because of the process itself.
There was a hand over here earlier. No?
Good.
Yes.
Looking at just the bits of your graphic novels up there and a little bit on the poster session, I got the impression they're fairly text heavy for graphic, just comparing all the other graphic I sort of vaguely know about. But I was thinking that, in fact, there's a lot of text in most, too. You spend a lot of time reading if you follow along. And just around Louis Riel also. But, you know, compared to Batman comics or even Kate Beacon, they look like there's a fair amount of reading to be done there. Is that sort of in the genre of the historical use of the graphic novel medium, that there's a fair amount of text? Or, I don't know, are there less text-heavy examples of a historical, engaged graphic novel?
Sure. One of my favorite graphic novels is called Matt Turner, and it's wordless, completely wordless. It's kind of a throwback to the Lynn Ward wordless lino cuts, and it depicts the Matt Turner rebellion without words. It's just sequential art telling a story. So that's on the very far side of, you know, historical comic having no words. But I think you're right. I mean, things like Louis Riel and Mouse are quite text heavy. And, you know, one thing that we could, if we had more time, we could show the projects, specifically the graphic history projects that we've worked on, have gotten less text heavy over time, because as a collective we have gotten better at telling stories through the comics medium, because we understand, you know, the very first comic, the Mayday graphic novel that we created in 2008 or 2009, we were still trying to figure out how that medium worked, whereas the kind of last comic that we created, Madeline Perron, almost has very little text. It's more prompt, word prompts with images kind of telling the story. So I don't think there's a right or wrong way to do it.
And I think it too, again, speaks to that collaborative piece. So within the Graphic History Collective, we have artists and writers, and we kind of learn to work together. Mm-hmm. And increasingly, I think as writers, we trusted and believed the artist who was saying to us, like, less words, less words. Yeah. And I think that's reflected over time. And some of the ones that are more text heavy, like the Days of Action one, for example, again, that was the first project for that artist and that writer who hadn't yet built that relationship. And one of the things was constantly trying to say to the writer, like, it's okay to use less words, it's gonna be okay. But I think, again, people who are trained as writers, we feel like that's, cutting that out is cutting out part of the message, right? And I think as you work together and build trust again between artists and writers, you can start to believe that you can still communicate without words.
Just to add, if I can, I've been taught now by a number of directors that I work with, you know, to have people talk less, mm-hmm. and to have them do more. Right? Because you have to have, they have to be doing something. It's really boring watching. So again, it's our inclination to hear them, whether it's to read them or listen to them, and rather think about, you know, well, body language of them doing something and choosing things that are important to them to do, and, you know, those tell stories in ways that we're not necessarily as historians trained to do.
I think, if I can jump in, I think it's respect for the medium, right? I share the same thing. But the tendency, I think, for a lot of academics when they get films, for instance, is to just make a filmic version of the book, which I think is pointless, because you're not making use of the medium. You know, cinema is image and sound. It shouldn't be words so much, right? So it's really immersing yourself in the medium and question, like, what is that for, and how does it do the same thing but differently? It's not going to be the same way as reading a book. I mean, that's why just different mediums exist, right? So, and I also think, on the other side, that judging a film about history against the book is totally unfair, because it's not going to be able to do the same thing. It was never meant for that in the first place. Right?
And that's one of the arguments that we make with the Graphic History Collective, is that comics require a type of engaged reading that other mediums might not have. I mean, the information in a comic is necessarily incomplete. That's the very nature of what a comic book is. And the reader has to put it together. It has to create their own meaning from it, from these kind of incomplete texts and images. So, I mean, I think that's it. Respecting the medium, understanding the medium. And so for people wanting to make comics, you know, it's important to understand the medium. But those who want to teach history through comics, I think it's also important to get students to think about how the message is not just what's written or what's visually depicted. It's how do you create new meaning from the combination of those two. And that's what I think is really exciting about the medium.
Well, it's funny, it goes back to something you were saying, Ronald, and I've had some conversations with other people too, talking about historians' failure to articulate, almost if we think of history as a medium kind of historical practice, that we don't really communicate well what it is we do. We have no problem telling people the content, but what it means to actually kind of do history.
Any final thoughts? Okay, well, if you haven't seen either the Thomas Wood Lost Stories Project, it's online for you to view, and if you haven't had a look at the exhibits in the King's Mill Room, you have a chance to do so now, but in the meantime, please join me in thanking our four presenters.
Yes.